Okay, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fourth meeting of 2021 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I'm pleased to welcome Maggie Chapman, MSP, who has now joined the committee as a full member, replacing Lorna Slater, MSP, and I look forward to working with Ms. Chapman. The first item of business is a declaration of interest from Maggie Chapman, and I invite Maggie to declare any interests that are relevant to the committee.
Thanks very much, Claire. I've got no financial interests relevant, but I refer members to my register of interests, and I am a member of Unite the Union. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next agenda item is to agree to take decisions. Agree to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are members content with that? Thank you. So our main public item of business this morning is an evidence session on support for economic recovery. I thank our first panel for joining us today, and I'd like to welcome Adrian Gillespie, who is Chief Executive, and Douglas Colquhoun, Chief Financial Officer from Scottish Enterprise, as well as Malcolm Roughhead, the Chief Executive of Visit Scotland. Today's evidence session will enable the committee to consider what policies are needed to promote economic recovery, and it also will be helpful to inform our pre-budget input to the Scottish Government's budget for 2022-23. Good morning to the panel. I would first like to ask, obviously we've come through an extremely difficult time through the pandemic, and your organisations have been vital in providing support for businesses across our economy, and particularly also within tourism. A fortnight ago, we did hear from Federation of Small Businesses and Chamber of Commerce, who did make some comments that they felt that Scottish Enterprise wasn't visible enough. They did feel the system was still too complex and prone to duplication. It has been a very challenging year, and I do appreciate that decisions had to be made quickly and often funds had to be put out quickly. But the sector did express some concerns that the way in which they interact with Scottish Enterprise could be improved. Are there lessons that you have learned during this process? And can I put that question to Douglas, please?
Thanks for the question, Convener. There's always lessons to be learned in a situation like we faced last year, but the criticism's a little bit unfair, I think. We delivered record levels of support to businesses last year, investing £568 million into Scotland's economy. We pivoted very quickly to deploying staff into supporting businesses that had been affected by COVID. We put out £220 million of emergency COVID grants that provided a critical lifeline to approximately 4,000 businesses, helped to safeguard more than 70,000 jobs. And on top of all that, we continue to deliver a lot of our what we call our business as usual activities in terms of economic development. It was a fairly, obviously a fairly extraordinary year in terms of our performance. Personally, I've got 34 years of experience with Scottish Enterprise, and I think I'll look back on last year as perhaps the most extraordinary year of delivery that we've experienced, considering our staff were all working remotely. And I suppose that takes me on to the point about visibility, because obviously in that kind of situation, then the more traditional methods and opportunities for networking have decreased over the last 18 months or so in terms of dealing with COVID. However, a lot of colleagues were involved with various industry groups right across the spectrum in terms of either helping to develop some of our responses to COVID or indeed just keeping people informed. We had people representing us and dealing with international policy on the committee of SEDI. We had very frequent COVID-19 business update calls, which are facilitated by Scottish Government, but attended by SE, Federation of Small Businesses, SEDI, Scottish Food and Drink, etc., almost on a daily basis before moving to weekly and then fortnightly as things moved on. So there was a large, although slightly different, period of engagement with industry bodies and industries and sectors across Scotland.
Thank you. That's helpful, and I do appreciate the response. Can I ask, there was an Audit Scotland report that was published this morning. I appreciate it's only been published this morning. You've possibly not had a chance to be aware of it. But Stephen Boyle was on radio this morning talking about the amount of funds that were put out during the COVID pandemic. There was a need to deliver funds at pace. I do recognise that. But he's raised some issues around transparency. And I would like to ask Malcolm, and I do hope we haven't lost Adrian, if Adrian is still on the call, I'd like to ask you both how challenging it was to administer the funds and if you're confident that there was a robust decision-making process put in place and that there is enough transparency about how funds have been delivered. If I go to Malcolm, first of all, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I think we benefited from coming in late in the process in terms of delivery of the funds, and it, certainly from our perspective, because it was bespoke for the tourism sector, it allowed us to work very closely with the various industry representative bodies, so that whilst it may have taken a little bit of time at the front end, it just meant that getting the money through the system and making sure that the applicants were aware of what they had to do was speeded up at the back end, because what it meant was we had fewer rejections and we also had fewer appeals, which actually sped the whole process up. So from our perspective, we've also been on every single fund. We've had our own internal audit people looking at it, taking on board all the lessons learned and then feeding those in an iterative process into the next delivery of any of the funds.
Thank you. And Douglas, would you like to respond to the question? Oh, I do understand Adrian is back. I'm maybe give Adrian a chance to contribute as he's managed to join us in the meeting. I understand there's connectivity issues there. I think that was a brief... Good morning, Adrian.
Yes, good morning, everyone.
Hopefully you heard the question. The question regarded the Audit Scotland comments this morning around transparency within the COVID funding delivery. And I was asking if you are confident that there was enough robust scrutiny and transparency around. I do appreciate that funds had to be distributed at pace, but do you have confidence in the systems that were put in place?
Thank you, and my apologies for missing the beginning of the meeting there. I've met with the convener of our audit committee, and he has told me about the scrutiny that these various funds have received. And our internal audit team were very satisfied with the robustness around the whole process, which I think, given the pace at which everybody had to move and some of the uncertainty we're dealing with, was very pleasing to hear. So, you know, on that basis, I'm very reassured that in the circumstances, the process was as robust as was possible.
And are you able to briefly respond to the comments we had from FSB and Chamber of Commerce, who did raise some concern about continuing complexity around the funding issues?
Yes, I caught the beginning of that just before I lost the connectivity. So, yeah, obviously, I was disappointed to read that. I'm new in post. I'm going to be engaging very broadly, including with those who submitted evidence to you. I do think that given just the amount of activity that you'll see in our submission that was put out during difficult circumstances, I think that's slightly unfair in terms of Scottish Enterprise not being out there. I think we were extremely connected into sectors, into the business organisations who we co-created a lot of these funds with. However, we can always do better. But I think sometimes as well, companies are often interacting with Scottish Enterprise and actually don't realise that they are. So the Find Business Support website that Scottish Enterprise operates was taking tens of thousands of phone calls, dealing with 40,000 inquiries to the website every month. But that's not Scottish Enterprise branded, but it's Scottish Enterprise people who are manning that service. And in fact, around 70 additional staff were brought into that service during the crisis. I think that can often not be appreciated, that companies are speaking to Scottish Enterprise. what we're trying to do there is make sure that it doesn't matter who you come into. It's about the support that we help companies to find, and that we can help companies access support from a broad range of partners. But I think sometimes it's not always clear that Scottish Enterprise is the person that you're speaking to.
Thank you. I'm now going to hand over to Jamie Halcrow-Johnson.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning to the panel. We've heard today that, you know, there's obviously, particularly from Scottish Enterprise's point of view, you continue to deliver growth. But throughout the pandemic, there's obviously been a focus on supporting existing businesses, supporting them through extremely difficult times. I just wanted to get an idea, and perhaps if I could come to Adrian Gillespie first, and then maybe onto Malcolm Roughhead. How that focus may have impacted on long-term growth in terms of, a focus away from perhaps new businesses. And as you go forward over the next few years, how you will balance supporting existing businesses which are still struggling or still need that support, and how you look to develop, and support new businesses and entrepreneurship.
Thank you. Yes, I'll take first. I think that will be something that we're just going to have to working as a team with the other agencies and being very close to companies to be very agile with that whole process. Clearly there are some parts of the economy that are still dealing with COVID and there's some challenges there, particularly in tourism and hospitality. Malcolm may come back to that. But still in sectors like aerospace, we're still, supporting companies through talent, but also at the same time, helping companies find markets, negotiate international markets, which are uncertain, either due to post-Brexit changes or particular COVID conditions in that country. So we're having to be very nimble and agile in terms of how we deliver that support. But often it can be support around dealing with some of the problems arising from COVID, and at the same time looking for new markets and growth opportunities. And I think, as we set out in our submission, the seven national opportunities, I think provide good focus and opportunity around growth in the future, while still helping companies around issues on skills shortages, on finance issues. And sometimes that can be about actually dealing with coming out of the COVID conditions and facing quite high growth. And some of the financial challenges that can go along with that. So I think the short answer is that we're going to have to be very agile in how we deliver that support, particularly through what remains some uncertain times, but that we do have a strong focus on the future opportunities at the same time.
Thanks. And to Malcolm as well, please.
We're in a kind of hybrid situation where some businesses have actually not had, been able to trade at all. Some have had limited trading, happily some are seeing green shoots of recovery. So they all need different types of support on an ongoing basis. And certainly there's a number of challenges there. And Adrian alluded to a number of them, things like labour shortages right across the board that we're going to have to collectively look at. Plan not just in the immediate future, but also for the medium and long-term future, because I think these have been underlying issues. There are things, we have issues around in the cities where footfall is increasing, but spend is still well down on pre-COVID levels. So again, it's about looking at how we can attract people into the cities and help businesses survive. Obviously, there's uncertainty around what's going to happen post-furlough and what the impact of that will be, and once loan repayments come in. Again, Adrian touched on that. From our own perspective, we've been taking the time to help people increase and enhance their digital capability, which means that their digital competitiveness is greater. We've been working with Digital Boost on the £25 million programme, And continuously, we're looking at online bookable products, so we're supporting businesses to become more responsible once we get through this period. I think also the research that, and insights that, that we conduct on an ongoing basis, we're able to share with businesses to determine where sentiment is strong towards visiting Scotland, but also looking at where some of the issues are in those markets, because what we have to remember is that particularly international inbound has been no business to speak of whatsoever for over 18 months. And each individual market has its own circumstances. So again, it's about keeping people informed in terms of opportunities around our core markets like Germany, France, North America, etc. But I would also say that the collaboration and partnership between all the agencies and the industry has been exemplary. And we are working through all of this together through the Scottish Tourism Emergency Response Group and also the Events Industry Advisory Group, which was set up and have delivered against a number of serious issues. But we're getting to a point where I think we're able to start the recovery phase over the next sort of few months.
Thanks for that. I'm getting quite a lot of feedback, so hopefully you can hear me okay. But I just, you know, on the points I think that you just made there, you said that you as agencies have had to do things differently. So I was just wondering how much you're having to focus on supporting businesses to do things differently, perhaps to the way they may have done before pandemic. We've heard a lot about, obviously, more businesses on needing to go online. I mean, that's been a fundamental issue that a lot of businesses didn't have a strong enough online offering. And I appreciate it may be different between the kind of general business side and the tourism sector side. But again, if I could maybe ask Adrian first, and then Malcolm, how you're supporting businesses within your sector to do things differently, and how important that's going to be going forward.
If the question's answered by Adrian, first of all, unless you have a problem with... if I hand over to Malcolm.
OK, thank you. You're absolutely right. I think the interesting aspect over the last 18 months has been, and you rightly point out, we've been behind the curve in the industry in terms of digital capability and competitiveness. But over the last 18 months, we've had to progress, and we've had to learn, and we've had to become more adept at using digital media. And we actually, what we've seen is in terms of businesses that are now online bookable, there's been a remarkable growth. It's been single digit growth for a number of years, but over the past 18 months, we've seen about 15 percentage points. So that's good, and people see the benefit of that. So what you're now doing is you're taking away perhaps some of the hesitation about getting into that particular arena. But we're also seeing diversification. So we've seen businesses that were business to business suddenly becoming business to consumer by selling direct online. And I think that's been helpful. We've also had we've been able to identify different channels. So we've been helping businesses to look at how their own websites are competitive, the type of content that they have, how capable the search engine optimization is. So we've been taking the time to get them ready to a state of preparedness, but when they're actually able to convert the interest, which undoubtedly is out there, into actual bookings. And again, that's all down to circumstance and you know, whatever's happening, not just in the UK and Scotland, but also in international markets.
Thank you. I'm afraid we'll need to make some progress. I'm going to hand over to Michelle Thompson for the next questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everybody. First of all, I wanted to just take us back a bit and just explore budget positions. Obviously, you've submitted some information, so I want to keep this quite snappy, this section. So for both of you, and it may well be more appropriate that Douglas comments... And yourself, Malcolm, I'm interested in a brief summary of what you believe your current budget positions to be. And of course, you'll be looking at next year in the light of a very uncertain trading environment for everybody. And I'm particularly interested in that forward-looking thing, what mitigations you're anticipating and your confidence about them, given the uncertainty over Scottish Government funding as well. So perhaps if I could come to Douglas first on that.
Thank you. In terms of the current year position, as we set out in our submission, we established a business plan budget of just over £404 million. That figure increased marginally to about £409 million once the final budget for the Energy Investment Fund has been confirmed by the Scottish Government. As we noted in our mission, we identified as in the income anticipated from financial transactions funded loan repayments amounting to about £20 million based on two organisations that were effectively looking to financially restructure. And therefore looking to delay the loan repayments, and one actually a much more positive position where we'd made an investment and the company's actually gone to do an initial public offering and has listed, and that will result in a substantial uplift in the value of our investment. But it means that effectively that £409 million has gone down to approximately £389 at the moment. Against that, our expenditure forecast are holding up very strongly. We've got about £386 million of activity forecast at the moment, and approximately 80% of that planned expenditure is currently legally committed. At the beginning of the year, when we set the budget, we made provision for two large inward investments. One of those, unfortunately, which was tied to the High Speed 2 development, is no longer progressing this year, and that released some money back into the capital budget. And what we've done is we've reallocated that budget in some very small slippage across the wider capital budget into our growth investments team that deals with early stage investment activity. Effectively, we've maintained their ability to support the Scottish early stage growth market through that. We had a very pleasant experience towards the tail end of last year. We had anticipated a lot of our income generation perhaps would fall away because of the impact of the pandemic. In some isolated instance, we've had some significant returns from equity investments that we held, and we anticipate that there's the likelihood that that will happen in the second half of this current financial year, which would generate some additional income and perhaps reinstate the budget back up closer to the £409 million.
Okay. I mean, you've given a lot of very clear data, and I thank you for that, Douglas. I suppose what I want to establish with you is your confidence level for your future projections in the light of an uncertain sort of settlement. How confident are you that you've got all your bases covered?
In terms of next year, 2022-23, well, we received a five-year capital budget allocation for last year and this year. That's reset our capital budget at £80 million next year, and that includes £10 million for the Green Jobs Fund. So it's a slight increase, a £7 million increase, not a slight increase, a £7 million increase on the current financial year. As you've noted, we've got the uncertainty of the comprehensive spending review relating to resource budgets, and we won't know the outcome of that until later in the year, but obviously we are making representations to Scottish Government about our requirements there in terms of some of the national programmes, the recovery and the growth plans that we have for next year. We have that continuing uncertainty about the financial transactions budget. And we're working very closely with the Scottish Government to get a better understanding as to what the amount will be. At the moment, we've got a confirmed figure for capital. We're working on the basis with the Scottish Government a flatline settlement in terms of a resource element of our budget, so that would be about £135 million. And we're working on the basis of about £21.5 million for financial transactions, which we'll augment by recycling income of about £5.5 million. We also, as part of our growth investment portfolio, equity portfolio, we now have quite a substantial listed shares portfolio in terms of companies that have moved through the various parts of the growth cycle to a part where now they are publicly traded. And what we'll do is we'll wait and see the outcome of the spending review, and then we will need to use that income to either make up financial transactions funding or a wider issue in terms of funding.
Okay, thank
Hopefully
you.
Hopefully that answers your question, Michelle.
Oh, yes, it does. Thank you. And so, Malcolm, I appreciate that you might want to take it up a level in your capacity. But so, just to reiterate, if you could just give me a sense of your current budget position and future projections and your confidence level.
Yeah, in 2021, what we do is we look at quarterly reforecasts based on the intelligence that we're getting from the market. Our case is slightly different, obviously, from Scottish Enterprise. We don't have equities, etc. But so for us, the risk is actually where can we operate and where can we generate the maximum value? So that means, just to use Adrian's word earlier, we have to be very agile in terms of how we deploy our resources, and that's why we do it on a quarterly basis, and it's all evidence-based. In terms of future plan, well, also I should say actually that our budget was increased from £41 million to almost £132 million, which was to help with delivery of the £80 million funding package that was announced last December. And we will also be delivering on behalf of the task force recommendations a fair proportion of the £25 million that's been allocated for recovery, and that work is actually underway and in some cases is actually being implemented as we speak. Going forward, it's very difficult, probably a bit easier for us to be fleet of foot in terms of where we shift our resources and our emphasis. But equally, it's as uncertain as it can be until we get a bit more clarity, particularly on the international front, because that is where it will also generate not just revenue, but also seasonality and geographic spread, and that's important to us.
I appreciate that's very complex for you. Moving on, because I'm conscious of time, for both of you, although I suggest that Adrian might want to come in on this one, we had some quite alarming stats presented to us from Women's Enterprise Scotland. There's a couple of questions off the back of that. One, an incidental one, because I'm also on the Finance Committee. I was quite shocked to hear that only 1% of private equity investment goes on women-led businesses, so obviously 99% on male-led businesses. So I'd like to know from Adrian and Malcolm, do you routinely disaggregate your data by gender, and do you therefore interrogate that data to get a kind of map of what your territory looks like in business support or business investment? And off the back of that as well, we've had commentary that the ability of women-owned businesses to access enterprise agency support has been harder because they tend to operate, so perhaps the beauty sector, for example, which isn't necessarily the focus for growth. So I'd like a bit of commentary on that. But starting off, do you routinely disaggregate data and then do you interrogate it? So Adrian, perhaps you'd like to go first.
Thank you. Yes, we do monitor this closely. Carolyn Curry has sent me the data that you saw, and we'll engage closely with Carolyn. Yes, you're absolutely right. There's more that needs to be done here. We monitor it closely in terms of the funding that we are involved in. Our high growth spin out programme, for example, our high growth ventures, the support for fast growing companies. We do have around 24% of the companies involved in that are female led. That's not enough, but it is growing. We have several initiatives, for example, Principally Women, where we work alongside other organisations supporting the leadership development of women into business. We've had six cohorts now, supported 87 women. We have Unlocking Ambition, which is an entrepreneurship development programme, has supported 107 entrepreneurs. Half of those are women. So we are making progress, but there's much, much more to be done here. But to answer your question, yes, we do monitor this.
OK, thank you. So, Malcolm, if you'd like to come in at this point.
Yeah, it's slightly difficult for us because there's no compulsory registration of businesses. So if you think about the makeup of the tourism industry with its bed and breakfast all the way through to self-caterers, it can be very, very difficult to get a handle on who the actual owner is or who the claimed owner is. And, you know, so for us, it is very much about working around careers within the industry. And we work very closely with women in tourism, for example. But we don't invest in businesses in the way that the enterprise companies do. So it would not be an area that we've addressed, but we can have a look at any data that we do have.
Thank you, Michelle. We'll now move on to Colin Beattie. If I can remind members that we do have a busy session this morning, if questions and answers could be succinct, that would be helpful.
Thank you, Convener. There's a couple of areas I'd like to ask a wee bit of question on. Probably the first one's for Malcolm. The Tourism Recovery Plan, Phase 1 and Phase 2, can you provide an update on that as to where we are on that? And is the expected funding for Phase 2 going to be in the scale that you would hope for?
Well, if I take the second part of that question first, that's actually been submitted now to the Scottish Government. So we just await the response on the Phase 2 proposals. Phase 1, I think, is well underway, as I mentioned. So there's an international marketing dimension. But actually, that starts. It's called Scotland is Calling, and it's focused in on the key markets, as I mentioned earlier. The UK and Scottish focused activities been underway for quite some time now. In terms of data, one of the projects there is about a data observatory based loosely on the kind of Portuguese model, whereby it's more about forecasting and looking at demand and matching that with supply. The current issue that we have really with data is it's historical and usually out of date and of little value, apart from possibly identifying, you know, trends, historical trends. So data is one of the areas that I think we've all accepted is there's a dearth of. And we need that, you know, for future planning and future proofing. So in terms of the other activities that are ongoing, the Skills Development Scotland and HIT and Scottish Tourism Alliance recruitment campaign for the industry has now come to a close. And the results of that will be made known very shortly, just in terms of the number of applicants, the number of hits on the website, the number of jobs posted, etc. So more than happy to provide the committee with that data as soon as it's available to us.
Can I ask how you're monitoring the success or failure of the different elements of Phase 1?
The evidence, as I said, in terms of participation, in terms of conversion, a lot of the activity that we run, we're actually able to evidence in terms of referrals into businesses and where businesses book directly through, for example, the likes of an intermediary, say Expedia, They'll share the data as well. So we're actually able to get a return on that investment and make sure that, as we say, that we're able to maximise the return that we want to generate.
Okay. When do you expect to...
Sorry, Mr Beattie. Colin Smith, did you want to come in particularly on tourism before...
Thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, it was just really a follow-up question to Collins and the questions for Malcolm. The summer was obviously incredibly busy with staycations. A lot of people who would normally have gone abroad for obvious reasons didn't and stayed in Scotland, and as a result, prices were quite high. Can I ask what Visit Scotland did, and maybe more importantly, are going to do differently to promote those areas that aren't obviously the most obvious destinations for mainly historic reasons rather than because they don't have a lot to offer? I mean, there are parts of Scotland that, if we're being honest, maybe don't need a lot of promotion, but there are others that are still very much untapped, and that whole interest in staycations gives us an opportunity to really promote those areas and boost numbers and make a big contribution to inclusive growth. And I'm sure Malcolm will know the areas I'm talking about down in South of Scotland, but you know, there's real potential that we've got a chance to really dig into.
You're absolutely right, and we are working with the various destination management companies, SSDA in the south, and right across the whole of the country. So we've been working at A, supporting them to get through this period, but B, also to look at their own capability. And I mentioned earlier about helping them with content, looking at search engine optimization. We have what we call regional takeovers, where we will feature an area. Just recently, it's been the Aberdeenshire, where all our social channels, you know, which are quite extensive in terms of global reach, feature a particular region. And what we do is we highlight, you know, sort of key things to see and do. We're encouraging people to make sure that they post their availability and their opening times, because right now at the moment, you know, there is uncertainty. People don't want to travel to places they don't know, if they don't know that something's going to be open or there's things for them to do there. So kind of some fairly basics that need to be put into place. But we've also been looking at the Destination Management Company Fund, which is to look at inbound tourism. So working with DMOs and tour operators to make sure that they can reach these different markets, but in a responsible way. So it's looking at itineraries that get people around the country rather than just in one place, so that they can get out and explore what there is to see and do in the region. There's quite a lot of work that's ongoing at the moment. And as I said right at the very beginning, the collaboration, you know, across the industry and between the various partners, I don't think has ever been closer or more productive.
Okay, thank you. I'll return now. I understand Colin Beattie has a further question.
Malcolm, just could you give me a sort of flavour as to the extent to which you're moving back to being a marketing organisation as opposed to a funding delivery organisation, which of course was inevitable during the pandemic?
Certainly, we've never stopped being a marketing organisation. It's just what we were trying to do during the pandemic was keep Scotland top of mind, as opposed to the conversion bit. So it was very much around the, you know, visit Scotland when you can, when circumstances allow. Obviously, we dialed down the level of expenditure so that we could put monies into supporting industry at the same time. And we were in a slightly fortunate position in that a couple of our business units, like the quality assurance team and the information centres, couldn't operate. So we were able to redeploy them into business support. So it hasn't impacted on what we're able to do. It's just the amount of what we do and the message at the end of it. Clearly, on our event side, through the Events Directorate, and in particular through Events Scotland, that had been particularly hard hit because events just couldn't take place. And again, a lot of that was looking at, you know, helping the supply chain through the Scottish Government funding that was granted to us.
Thank you. I'd like to just briefly ask Adrian a question here on the criticism that there's been of the enterprise boards in relation to the levels of contacts and and interface with the various trade organisations, the FSB and others. Do you recognise these criticisms? There's a feeling that during the pandemic in particular, the contact was very poor.
I think we've lost connection with Adrian, so if Douglas maybe wants to briefly respond to that.
Hope he's there.
Could we have he's Douglas's muted. Microphone on, please?
I'm uncertain.
Sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Did you catch the question?
I did, thank you very much, Colin. I think Adrian covered it in an earlier response. Obviously, we look and he will reach out to FSB and others in terms of some of the comments they've made to you. I think it was, as I covered in my earlier answer, I think it was obviously a unique circumstance. I think, as Malcolm covered off, we work closely with a whole range of industry bodies and representative bodies in terms of trying to agree how we respond to COVID, etc. So I think the criticism's a little bit unfair and possibly, as I said earlier, we had a COVID response group set up ostensibly under Scottish Government umbrella, but involving the FSB and others, and we were there too. So there was opportunities to engage with all these groupings. But as I say, Adrian will take on board the comments that have been made, and we'll reach out to these groups to improve the relationships with them.
Okay, thank you. I'll now move on to Fiona Hislop.
Thank you and good morning. Good to see you, Malcolm, and can also congratulate Adrian on your recent appointment, and good to see you, Douglas. I want to ask about supply chains resilience. In Scottish Enterprises submission, you highlight your work in increasing the PPE supply chain, and that was really significant. I'm interested in what you're doing going forward in other areas, but specifically, you'll be familiar with the recent decision by the UK government in relation to Valneva, and obviously with a significant promise of investment in that area. Clearly, I don't expect you to comment on the rationale or the inconsistency of the UK government's decision making in this, but it's a major opportunity in terms of life science investment globally going forward. So I'd just be interested to hear what you're doing specifically now and to support the business minister in his engagement with the company, and also if Scottish Enterprise could talk about your wider work in supply chain development and resilience. And then to Malcolm, if you could maybe comment on supply chain resilience for the tourism sector. Clearly, there's a great deal of pressure there, so if you could perhaps give us some initial comments and what might help to mitigate some of that, bearing in mind some of those issues maybe out with the control, for example, of Visit Scotland. So first of all, maybe if I can come to Adrian.
Thank you. Yes, and apologies about my connection again. I'll try to answer this and hopefully the connection won't drop in the meantime. Yes, we learned a lot from the COVID experience, and I'm putting that into practice, particularly around these new opportunity areas that we're seeing in emerging areas like hydrogen, in health technologies, health manufacturing. We're involved in several initiatives which are specifically looking at supply chain development. For example, in medicines manufacturing, the Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre that's currently being built outside Glasgow Airport is going to bring together a supply chain of all different sizes. And we're increasingly putting supply chain practice into the development of our clusters, using the range of companies that we work with, but also with companies our partners are working with to bring that together. On Valneva specifically, yes, we are connected into that, and we're closely engaged with the Minister, and I believe there will be further meetings on that today. So we will be staying very close to that and supporting whatever emerges out of the current discussions.
I suspect, Convener, that we might want to hear more about that wider supply chain development, but we might not have time today for that. But I'm sure if we can follow up with Scottish Enterprise to get more detail on what you've gone through, Adrian, it sounds very promising. Malcolm, do you want to comment from a tourism industry point of view?
Thank you very much, and you'll be very familiar with one aspect of it on the event side. So clearly, you know, it's great to see events starting up again, which will relieve some of that pressure, because they are micro businesses in many cases, and the support we know that was given to them to get them through to this point was very gratefully received, and many of those businesses wouldn't have been here had it not been for that. Equally so on the sort of wider tourism side, the whole Love Local aspect, I think, has been incredibly successful, where we're seeing local suppliers being preferred over, you know, perhaps some of the more kind of corporate type of businesses. And that all adds to the authenticity and the sense of ownership and community. So the more that we can promote that, the better. So I'd really like to see this being an ongoing situation, as opposed to you know, people suddenly going back to how it used to be, because I think it's just brought so many people together, and it's opened up. I mentioned the word diversification much earlier on. It's opened up new business opportunities for businesses that hitherto perhaps were maybe slightly one-dimensional in their business model approach. And I think that also allows for local employment, because it creates those opportunities. Talking about people, of course, we have a big issue right across many sectors. It's not just in the tourism hospitality, in terms of the labour shortage. And I think, you know, there is a kind of question there about whether we need a national task force or a sector-specific task force to look at what we can do now, but also how we prevent this from happening going further down the line.
Thank you. I'm very conscious of time, but I'm sure we might want to come back to the agencies at some point about these issues.
Thank you. That's much appreciated. I now move over to Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the information that you have all provided so far this morning. I want to pick up on something that allows us maybe to look ahead and see how planning is shaping up for the immediate future, but also longer term. The transition to net zero is expected to be a significant theme across the new economic strategy for Scotland. And a question possibly for both Adrian and Malcolm: how aware and prepared do you think businesses in your areas are? And what is your organisation doing to support this transition? Do we need to be thinking about different approaches around increased conditionality, for instance, with notions of fair work and that move to net zero as we look ahead? Thank you. Adrian first, and then Malcolm.
Thank you. Yes, the transition to net zero is a huge opportunity. It's central to our current business plan. It'll be central to our next business plan that we'll be publishing next year, a three-year plan. In terms of business readiness, it's a mixed picture. We've surveyed businesses that we work with. Around half are advanced or have taken large steps towards net zero, but that leaves half for whom this this remains something where a large amount of Scottish enterprise support and support of our partners is essential. We do that in a number of ways. We have funding mechanisms in place, the Low Carbon Transition Fund, for example, and we set an example as an agency in terms of our targets around net zero and their practices. But there is much more to be done. We have within our key new opportunities areas, you see low carbon opportunities like hydrogen being front and central in terms of where we think the future opportunities lie, and we will be focusing our activities. It's hugely important, and it's a big area of focus for us.
Thank you. Malcolm, do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you very much. Prior to COVID, actually, the 2030 tourism strategy had responsible tourism at its heart. So I think all this has done is accelerate the necessity to get that up and running and back on track. I think also the whole issue around leadership, which Adrian refers to there, is about what's Visit Scotland as an organisation going to do. It's all very well, you know, sort of talking the talk, but we need to walk the walk. So if we're going out there talking about the opportunities, talking about the need to, you know, to get to net zero, then we have to deliver ourselves. And as an organisation, we through our board have just agreed our own strategy going forward to 2030 to become a net zero organisation by then. What I'd like to see is also the opportunity when we look at our impact assessments in terms of the activity, that we also build in a view on the carbon emissions from that activity and how we can mitigate those.
Thanks, Malcolm. And I suppose there's a link there with what you were what you said in answer to a previous question around diversification and the Love Local, that, you know, there's a huge opportunity there. Just extending this a little bit and looking maybe a little bit more broadly. Decades of business support and economic development have not really changed systemic issues in our economy. Low productivity, stagnation in rates of entrepreneurialism and so on. What is it that we could be doing better so we don't just keep doing more of the same in the coming years? And how can we do that better in a way that we actually drive the change in directions we need to see, not only around net zero, but longer term, you know, thinking more broadly as well. Adrian and Malcolm again, if I can ask both organisations, thank you.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you for that question. You're correct in what you say in terms of, you know, some of the significant measures we need to shift them, and the work that's underway at the moment around the Economic Transformation Plan, I'm sure we'll be focusing strongly on that. In terms of my thoughts on the matter, some of these indicators are absolutely key, and something I want to put much more focus on over the coming years is this measure around the amount of innovation and the amount of research and development that happens in Scotland as well, because I think if we have innovative companies, then we have you know, significant impacts on measures like productivity, investment, and particularly in internationalisation and levels of international trade. So whilst it's really important that we focus on these markets, it's I would say even more important that we work with companies to give them all the support we can around being innovative, adopting innovative work practices, harnessing all the assets that they have, particularly the creativity and the skills of their workforces. That's something we've made significant steps in, I think, over the last few years. We established the workplace innovation team, and we work very closely with companies and partners around ensuring that everybody can contribute, that there's an employee voice, and that to me is critical for innovation. So if there's one thing I think we need to put much, much more focus on, and I want SE to put much more focus on, it's working with many, many more companies around becoming more innovative and developing their workplace practices. I think that can make a significant difference. But it will take focus, I think. You know, these are not insignificant challenges, and as you correctly say, they are long-standing challenges. But I think it's one that with concerted effort that we can start to shift, and in fact, around some of the focus on innovation, which we put in place in my last spell in Scottish Enterprise, we did start to see those numbers of innovative active companies really starting to shift in the right direction. So I'm optimistic that we can make a big difference here through focus and through extending our support to many, many more companies.
Thank you, Adrian. Malcolm, do you want to come in on that?
Yes, I would agree wholeheartedly with Adrian, but I think also what we need to remember is that tourism is a people business, and it's about interaction. It's about, as I said, that authenticity, which comes from community ownership as well. So what we have to do is make sure that the conditions are right, that the support mechanisms are in place, and I've mentioned many times today the use of technology, which allows people, you know, to not only be more competitive, but also to reduce their own costs, which they can then be, you know, encouraged to invest in their businesses. So I think that business support and advice going forward is going to be very, very important. And I would only caution that, you know, productivity in certain sectors is not going to be the same as in, for example, you know, sort of highly mechanised and automated sectors. So to compare, for example, life sciences with tourism is actually, I think, you know, giving a false picture.
Thank you. Can I now bring in Alexander Burnett for his question?
Thank you very much, Convener. I could start by thanking Malcolm for his recent spotlight on Aberdeenshire and hope maybe when he's had a chance to collate some of those figures, we can hear how that work went on, particularly if a tour of Britain is, you know, set to benefit the North East for the next decade. My question is for Scottish Enterprise. From the recent annual report, I'm looking at a table produced by SPICE for us around your primary outcome measures. You know, whilst for planned R&D investment, planned capital expenditure, you know, pretty much held their own in the circumstances, growth funding and planned international export sales have halved. And so really first question would be to Douglas to maybe comment on the figures of what the projections are and what we could expect in the coming year. And then for Adrian, I suppose, what are you going to do to improve our export sales? And yeah, what kind of interaction goes on with the Department of International Trade? I know the UK new investment offices and the new export support service is starting up. How does that interaction happen between yourselves and them? What would you ask of MSPs in finding businesses in our constituencies or regions with export potential? And I suppose just from the recent problems with connectivity, what are the major impediments do you think we have to improving exports? Thank you. Douglas first and then Adrian.
Thanks for the question. Yeah, obviously, as you pointed out, investment in R&D and capital investment held up rather well in the situation last year. Obviously, in this combination of factors, the EU exit and obviously COVID meant it was much more difficult for exporters to reach the markets, etc., and develop new markets, etc. So that's an area that Scottish Development International is very strongly focused on in terms of economic recovery this year. We still think it will be obviously trading conditions are being affected. We still think it will be something along the lines of 1.1 billion in terms of exporting activity. In terms of investment activity, which you referred to, I mean, we invested £76 million last year through our growth investments team. We remain one of the top 10 investors across the UK in terms of supporting early stage growth investment, and we will continue to do that in the current year. That's kind of you know, the situation that we find ourselves in. We are a gap funder, so we are dealing with the kind of riskier end of the market, and obviously we're relying on private sector partners also to bring forward deals to enable that to happen.
Thank you. So just one follow-up on that, Douglas. What kind of metric do you have for the international export sales in terms of, you know, money spent by yourselves to the return?
Well, we monitor the support, financial and advice, etc., that we provide, and then monitor along with the companies that we reach out to and engage with to see how their international sales have increased as a result of that. So that's basically the metric we're looking at. The direct financial support tends to be very little. We delivered a lot of support last year virtually, I think is referenced in the response to you, or submission to you. Obviously, given the situation, a lot of trade events, as Malcolm alluded to earlier, were also cancelled as well. So we found different ways of dealing with that, hosting kind of virtual meetings between overseas buyers and Scottish companies, and a way of and using our global Global Scots network to facilitate some of those introductions as well.
Thank you. And Adrian, how are we going to improve the export situation?
Thanks, OK. And just to comment on the measures, we are seeing a recovery in inward investment starting at the moment and some positive signs there. I mentioned earlier about some of the complexities around international trade. We work very closely with the Department for International Trade, particularly out in markets. Our staff are co-located in the majority of cases, and we share information and we work together. I mentioned earlier, I think one of the most significant impacts we can make on numbers of exports are around more companies innovating, around international markets. I see that's absolutely critical. We know that innovative companies are much, much more likely to export. So the more focus we can put on that early stage, that pipeline, I think the support in market is very, very good, and the contacts we make in market are very, very good. But we need more pipeline. We need more companies that are innovating for international markets. So as I mentioned in my last response, that's where we'll put a big focus.
Thank you. And if there are companies within our constituency or regions, what advice and what direction should we be giving them? Just sending them to yourselves?
Yes, well, initially the Find Business Support website is the best way of accessing the support of all of the partners, and between us we'll find the best and most appropriate support for them. So that would be the first point of entry.
Thank you very much. That's all. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Alexander. Gordon MacDonald, do you wish to come in to ask the panel any questions?
No, I'm fine, thanks.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the panel for their time this morning. That brings us to the end of this evidence session. So thank you to Adrian Gillespie, Douglas Colquhoun and Malcolm Roughhead for attending. We'll now have a short break to allow for the changeover of witnesses. We can now turn to the second panel of witnesses this morning. And can I welcome Carol Buxton, Interim Chief Executive, with Nick Kenton, Director of Finance and Corporate Services from Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and Jane Morrison-Ross, who is the Chief Executive, and Anthony Day, Director of Finance from the South of Scotland Enterprise. Welcome to the committee this morning. Can I start by asking the Chief Executive of both organisations? We have been through a very difficult time with the pandemic and the difficulties there are for businesses. The committee recognises that. What do you think are the most pressing challenges that are facing businesses within your regions? And if I go to Jane first, please.
Good morning. We know that businesses within the south of Scotland are struggling at the moment with some of the impacts of leaving the European Union. We are seeing challenges around supply chain. We're seeing challenges around skills shortages, but more than skills shortages, actual shortages of people to take up some of the posts, particularly in haulage, in manufacturing, in tourism and hospitality as well. So we are seeing some major impacts across all of those areas. A secondary one that we're seeing at the moment is actually abundance of applicants for some jobs, particularly in professional categories, but a shortage of housing across the south of Scotland is now also coming into play.
Thank you, Jane. There are obviously significant challenges. Is there any kind of immediate responses you can see the Enterprise Agency offering to ease some of these, or are they just too difficult to address in the short term?
No, we're working across a number of areas to address these, both in the short, medium and longer term. We're working on some aggregated supply chain solutions. We're working with our regional social landlords. We're working with our tourism businesses to look at aggregated supply chain solutions in both those areas. We're looking at solutions around energy. We're working with the construction industry and the Construction Industry Innovation Forum, as well as supporting training and additional opportunities in haulage and additional measures to help address driver shortages. We're also working with both colleges and the tertiary education providers across the region to identify and address additional skills gaps that we can close quickly. The housing challenge is a slightly more difficult one, but we are working with both of the councils and the Regional Economic Partnership to look at what can be done there.
Okay, thank you very much, Jane. Can I put the same questions to Carol, please?
Thank you. I think while there are still significant challenges in the region around COVID and Brexit, there are signs of optimism now. Our recent business panel survey, where we survey 1,000 businesses from across the region in all sectors, you know, more than half, well over half, felt much more positive now about the economic recovery in Scotland. That said, you know, the impact of the pandemic was felt very strongly in the Highlands and Islands. We've got a very high dependence on sectors that were probably hardest hit by COVID and by Brexit, with tourism, food and drink, and the creative sectors. In the main, the challenges have been very similar to those outlined by Jane. Recruitment challenges, particularly in rural and island areas, where anecdotally, we don't have figures at the moment, but you know, staff shortages have resulted in reduced opening hours or maybe closing on certain days or not providing specific services on certain days. And similarly with Jane, housing, 40% of employers who were citing labour market or workforce supply issues cited availability of housing or access to housing as a key constraint. Similarly, supply chain issues, we're all very well aware of supply chain issues in construction, both in terms of material shortage and an increase in price. That said, again, businesses have been being innovative in how they address that. For example, you know, in the food and drink sector, we've worked with some businesses to look at a logistics platform for businesses to help them work together collaboratively to ensure they can get their goods to market timeously and to their customers. So I think those are probably the key ones. I think finally, I suppose there still is, particularly in the SME sector, uncertainty around what's going to happen next, which does have an impact on how they plan and how they feel about the future.
Thank you very much. I'll now bring in Jamie Halko-Johnson.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. Good morning again to the new panellists on that. Can I ask, firstly, Carol, and then perhaps Jane Morrison-Ross, as well as the chief executives of two organisations. Throughout the pandemic, there's been a need to support businesses in terms of getting them through the pandemic. But as we come out of that, how you will balance the need to continue to support certain sectors, but also to ensure that that new businesses, new startups, entrepreneurship, and just particularly to Jane Morrison-Ross as a relatively new organisation, whether you feel that you've got both the budget and the resources to be able to do that. If I can go to, say, Carol Buxton first, and perhaps then Jane Morrison-Ross.
So specifically on budget initially, is it Jamie, you're asking about the potential to support?
Well, it was real. I mean, if you've got a concern over your own budget, then I'm happy for you to raise it here as well. But the question really was about how you provide that balance between supporting businesses and, as I say, still continue to support new businesses and entrepreneurship.
I think we as an organisation run entrepreneurship programmes, and they're always very well, you know, received by entrepreneurs in the region. We've got some specific programmes, entrepreneurship programmes aimed at young people, called Impact 30, which is primarily focused on the under 30s. And as I say, those programmes are very well subscribed and very popular. As an organisation, as you know, we are very place-based, so we do look at a range of businesses across the area. We will look at business startups where there's an opportunity to do so, for example, when there's no displacement. So I think we have a very good range of supporting startups alongside Business Gateway, and we have a very good relationship with Business Gateway. We're co-located in certain areas, so they can move businesses through the system, maybe from a very early startup stage to high. We provide advice and information to startup businesses, mainly through the Fine Business Support website, which you've already heard about, but also about direct engagement with staff in our area offices. In terms of our budget currently and into the future, we'll maybe talk about more about that later. But I do think we do have capacity to support both growth businesses and smaller startup businesses. We have a client segmentation model that looks from, you know, almost a pyramid of support, starting with international global businesses at the top, who we don't always engage with on a sort of financial intervention basis, but more about making connections, working with them to find solutions to any issues that they may have. Then we have our high impact clients, where we see that there's a lot of opportunity for growth, and we will have development plans with them, which can have a bespoke programme of support. And then, as I mentioned previously, our place-based organisations, which may be a business that's vital in a particular community and sees an opportunity, and we can intervene with them on a one-off transactional basis over a period of years to support them to either pursue opportunities that they've identified or address barriers. I mean, we've talked some about the barriers already in terms of logistics, for example, in some of our more peripheral areas. So yes, I think we have capacity to do both.
Okay, Jane Morrison-Ross.
Good morning, thank you. Yes, I mean, it's a very interesting time for us. As we've come out of COVID response, we have looked long and hard at our organisation at the end of year one, as you would do normally. We have actually done an organisation redesign and restructure to make us a simpler organisation to engage with, and more efficient and effective use of our processes, with the ambition to be as lean and green as we possibly can. As part of that, we have appointed a new head of innovation and entrepreneurship and a new head of digital development. And those two areas are working very closely together to look at what we need to do, not just in terms of startup and scale up, but pre-startup spark support, if you like, looking across the south of Scotland at the opportunities for innovation, not just technology enabled innovation, but innovation in traditional industries, perhaps enabled by technology, and innovation in the supply chains around those traditional industries. So in natural capital, for instance, forestry, agritech, and other areas like that. To make it as effective as possible, we've also done a complete review of our client journey and client experience from first point of contact onwards, to make that as efficient and effective as possible. It's a huge area of opportunity for us. And as part of that, we now have Business Gateway in-house in the Scottish borders, and we're working with Dumfries and Galloway Council on opportunities to do something different in that area as well. But it means that we are able to develop a one-stop shop, a one window, if you like, to the support services that we are currently developing and currently delivering, because we're doing two things in parallel at the moment. We are also working with a number of partners, from chambers to Small Business Federation, Women in Enterprise and others, to look at how we can grow and increase women in enterprise, and also support underrepresented founders across all of the industry sectors too. In terms of budget, I think much as Carol has said, we are able to do what we need to do within that at the moment. We haven't finished recruitment. We were forecast originally by the end of year two to be around 170 people. We believe we can come in under that figure, but still be resourced to deliver and resourced to deliver in new areas that are going to be critical going forward, like internationalisation and export, which is an area, again, that we believe offers huge opportunities for companies and organisations across the south of Scotland. I think in terms of areas where we will need to look long and hard at our capacity to increase the support and the funding that we have available to businesses in the south of Scotland, digital is going to be one area where we will want to ramp up that support. Again, we're not going to reinvent wheels, and we're working with a number of partners from Census and Data Lab onwards.
Oh, that's great. I'm very kind of conscious of time, so if I could just ask one question to both of you again very quickly. You've talked about some of the limitations, and you've just highlighted there digital. We've seen today some of the issues around it. So given the kind of issues that we're facing kind of with rural broadband and the nature of the two areas that you cover, can you tell me what we need to do and how you can work to try and bring, deal with some of those barriers, particularly around digital? And also, you mentioned the rural housing issue, what we need to see from Scottish Government to address that issue, because, as you say, you know, you can have jobs in a place, but if you haven't got the broadband, if you haven't got the rural housing and some of the other services, that makes it very difficult for businesses to grow, to expand, and to encourage people to kind of come in and move in. If I can go to Jane Morrison-Ross on that first, please.
Certainly. Thank you. We are looking hard at the connectivity landscape in the south of Scotland just now. The full rollout has only been in play in the south for a number of months. So part of it is managing expectations. We're not as far ahead with broadband rollout as some other areas, but it is in progress now. Our new head of digital has been looking at that, and we believe we will hit around 87% coverage when that's finally rolled out, potentially higher. We are looking at the potential for closing some of those gaps in partnership with existing businesses in the south of Scotland that provide additional last gap services around that, to address how we can close that final mile to some of the businesses and organisations, particularly in our more remote and rural locations. In terms of housing, this is a newer issue for us, I think, than it is perhaps for High. So we have already written to Scottish Government to ask for consideration of the number of houses, the targets for number of houses to be built across the south of Scotland. We are working with the regional social landlords just now, and we are also looking at the capacity for reuse of derelict buildings, which could be an interesting project, we believe, particularly supporting the regeneration of some of our towns across the south of Scotland. There's a real opportunity there.
Thank you. And Carol, very briefly as well, please.
Yeah, well, again, we've been heavily involved in digital infrastructure for some time. There's still a little bit of a journey to go on in the Highlands and Islands, as you know yourself, and we're working very closely with Scottish Government and others to try and fill what gaps remain. In terms of uptake of digital, we have been very, very active in promoting digital uptake, encouraging people to sign up for improved connectivity, and then trying to demonstrate to them what they can actually do with that digital connectivity, because it's a means to an end, not an end in itself. Over the past year, we've run a series of digital enablement grant schemes, which is, you know, encouraging businesses to invest further in both digital hardware, software, and skills. They can use those grants for a variety of things. And on the housing issue, again, we've been working with a number of partners in both the private, public, and social sector to look at different models of providing housing. We've done some surveys into whether the housing needs demand assessment actually works in rural areas for small developments. We're looking at, as I say, different models, maybe supporting the private sector with housing development in areas of greatest need. I think more importantly, or also importantly in the Highlands and Islands, is our work with communities and how we can support communities to actually develop their own houses. And there are some very good examples of that, for example, in Colonsay and other more peripheral areas of our region. So I think there are opportunities there to work with community landowners, community organisations to undertake development at their own hand.
Thank you both. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Michelle Thompson.
I'll start first of all with the two FDs, Anthony and Nick. You may have seen if you watched the last panel, I wanted to explore to what extent you were confident about your projections for your next year's budget, given considerable uncertainty, what you'd looked at in your kind of scenario planning and your confidence level around that. So if you can keep it brief, I don't need to go through every single budget line. It's really just to get a sense of where you're at with that. So perhaps, Anthony, you might like to go first.
Hey, thanks, Michelle. So I guess in terms of confidence in next year, we're slightly different from the other two agencies in that it's our second year, and we've been talking with government around what the plan was going to be. So in terms of capital, there is a five-year capital plan, so we expect a slight increase in capital next year and somewhere in revenue. We realise that government are currently embarking on that spending review, and we will seek clarity with it as soon as we can, feeding into that process. If that's the settlement we get that we expect in terms of 17 million in $17 million revenue and 50 million in capital and 5 million in FT, then we would see that as sufficient to meet the needs as we're forecasting and scenario planning just now. But as you indicated, it is dependent on conversations with government and how that spending review goes.
And therefore, if you don't get those, what you've done your projections on, have you got mitigations in place?
Yeah, so in terms of the scenarios that we would do, is I think the first part is continuing to talk to government about trying to meet any gaps that arise. The second part would be some of what Jane had alluded to, and indeed Carol, and partnership working, where we can leverage other funds that are out there and working. So the Team South of Scotland approach, so with councils, a part of the Team South of Scotland, the regional economic strategy, so how we do that with both councils and NHS and other partners. I think Jane mentioned people like Data Lab and whatnot in terms of digital. So I think those are the starts of the mitigations in terms of filling any gaps that may arise as a result of the spending review.
And how about yourself, Nick, then, turning to you?
Yes, thank you. So for begin with capital, as others have said, we had notification of our indicative capital next year, and it shows a slight increase from 25 to 20.6 million on baseline, and an increase on the Green Jobs Fund from 800,000 to 1.4 million. And we also expect some funding regarding the Green Statement of the Funicular Railway at Cairngorm, which is a particular pressure for us. So we're obviously in close dialogue with the Scottish Government about that. At the moment, we're not fully legally committed for next financial year, but that's always would be the case in 6 months away. And when I say legal commitments, I mean projects which are, as it says, worthy. We've signed on the dotted line, but what we have really is a strong pipeline, and that's what we're working on, just to make sure there's a really healthy pipeline to make sure we can utilise all the budget. So I don't think there's a problem in terms of being overcommitted. Of course, we'll always discuss with the government any opportunities we have, but I think we have sufficient to meet our current pipeline of capital, bearing in mind all the pressures that we've heard on capital funding. So we've had to be very fleet of foot, move things around quickly. And in the yield we've just finished, for example, we secured £6 million of additional funding right in the last 2 months from the government, which we were able to get that out into the economy. So being fleet of foot is really important. And I would also emphasise the points made earlier about it's not just about our own funding, it's signposting to other funding that's available. On revenue, we don't know what that will be yet. We're modelling a flat cash scenario. Again, at the moment, we're not fully committed, but I wouldn't expect us to be at that time. So we work on that, and we are particularly revisiting all our pipeline projects at the moment in the light of net zero and Fair Work to make sure we sort of make sure all those golden threads are featuring in all our pipeline projects. So we're still working on that. In terms of financial transactions, that's still quite a new budget for HAI. We've got 2.6 million this year. If we assume the same next year, I think we will have headroom. We've actually struggled to spend that in the last couple of years. It's probably a combination of it being something new to HAI being focused on COVID funds, and also probably a lack of appetite for debt out there. So it's something we still need to work on. And we're in discussion with the Scottish Government about how we make best use of the financial transactions budget. So I think it's probably a summary of where we're at the moment.
Right, very helpful, thank you. And moving on next then to bring in Jane and Carol. Nick used a term there, golden thread, and I suspect one of my golden threads to obtain diversity in our economic output is to make sure that women-led businesses are adequately represented. Now, there's been a lot of chat. We know that women have been disproportionately affected, and I suspect that women-led businesses have been disproportionately affected. So I'd like some commentary, probably from yourself first, Jane, and then bringing in Carol, some commentary about what your observations are. Thank you.
Thank you. We do see this as an area of opportunity in the south of Scotland and do recognise some of the challenges in the research that Wes recently published, and we are working with them as well as other partner specific interventions and specific support that we can give, not just around startups, but around, I mentioned earlier, that pre-startup spark. We know there are women out there with amazing ideas, but perhaps lacking in the confidence or the channels to take that further. So we're working on that just now, and that's part of the remit that comes under our new Head of Innovation and Entrepreneurship. Again, we are working with appropriate partners to do identify and deliver that right across the south of Scotland. And in addition to that, the underrepresented founders generally that come under additional areas of potentially diversity and inclusion too.
Carol?
I know we looked at some of the information provided by Wes recently, and probably the levels of grant award were kind of tracking the number of women-owned businesses, but obviously we want to increase those. We've got a very good proportion of women participants across our business support programmes, for example, entrepreneurship. Across the programmes as a whole, there's about a 45% female participation, but that rises to nearly 60% on leadership programmes, for example, which I think is very positive, because it's from these programmes that businesses then can move to accessing other services and support from HAI. We've also run and participated in a really positive women entrepreneurship programme down on the west coast of our area, which provides more sort of gender sensitive support and helps businesses look at, you know, how they can access finance from other lenders, etc. So I think good participation rates at a programme level, which we are seeing beginning to filter through into other forms of support, such as financial support.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much, Claire, and thanks to the panel for joining us this morning. I've got two questions in two different but connected areas, and the first is around place-based economic development. The Advisory Group on Economic Recovery suggested that we need more regional place-based approaches to economic development, as the current system is perhaps a little bit too top-down. Can you tell us, do you expect to see regional place-based approaches in the new economic development strategies that are currently under development? And what learning you have from your own, given that you are regional-based organisations, what learning can you give us for thinking about this more generally? And maybe Jane and Carol to answer these, please.
Thank you. We have been involved in the consultation around the development of the 10-year transformation strategy and understand that that strategy is designed, will be designed to be truly transformational. We have been strongly encouraging that a place-based focus is part of that. A sectoral approach is perhaps not as useful for us in the south of Scotland. We have industry clusters that are probably part of national sectors rather than sectors in their own right. And we do find it extremely useful to be able to tailor interventions to our place. We have dispersed and rural economies across the south of Scotland. We have real innovation in multiple sectors from manufacturing to natural capital to agriculture. But they do need slightly different mechanisms of support and perhaps a more tailored one-to-one approach. We also recognise that a number of the organisations and communities we work with, which is as important to us, need longer-term support and intervention to get from where they are now to a place where they can fully take advantage of the support that we can provide and the support that partner agencies can provide, whether that's one of our sister enterprise agencies or SDI or indeed DIT or others. So the ability to tailor and focus by place is hugely important to us, and that's also reflected in the work of the Regional Economic Partnership that has now published for final approval the Regional Economic Strategy for the South of Scotland. And there are six thematic areas in that that we believe will dovetail well with the current national strategies that are in development, but they also reflect place very strongly, specific needs of place, and the ambition that we're seeing reflected right across the south of Scotland too.
Thank you, Jane. Carol, do you want to come in?
Thank you. Yes. Well, I would endorse and agree with everything that Jane said. And as you would expect, HAI is advocating very, very strongly not only a regional, but a place and more locally based approach to economic transformation in the upcoming strategy. We're a regional organisation, we're a dispersed organisation, we've got our, you know, offices and staff based across our region, which is a very large region. It also has within it a number of fairly distinct economies. We don't look at the economy as, you know, the economy of the Highlands and Islands as one big economy doesn't necessarily work. There are very, very local disparities across the area which require a much more tailored and responsive approach to both business and community development. And we do that through our structure. I would think one thing I would say is that at a Scottish level, we probably need to look at collectively at how we assess outcomes and impacts relating to specific investments. You know, as you can imagine, a relatively small intervention in a small community or a more peripheral area can have a very, very significant impact on that area. You know, it's maybe won't be hundreds of jobs, but in some places in our region, a handful of jobs can make the difference. So I think we need to look at return on investment in a slightly different way. We're also working at the moment on a tool to help us prioritise and assess very much that different type of development. How do you compare apples with oranges? And we're looking at various aspects and features of particular communities or economies in our area to see how specific interventions, how could we measure the comparative impacts within those to help us prioritise decision making.
Thanks very much for that. Carol, we might come back to you on that tool and the learning that you get from that, because that sounds really, really
okay.
Interesting.
And, yeah, I mean, very happy.
In some ways, what you were both talking about, linking economic transformation to community well-being, I think is really, really important. And that is a feature, that's a strand of work that's in development around the wellbeing economy. And my second question is on that. How are you supporting businesses, and how are you actually modelling the leadership to enhance activities in line with the wellbeing economy? And I suppose I'm particularly interested in the links to community wealth building and those kinds of fundamental transformations that will change how people relate to their local economies, never mind in any broader economic system. Thank you. Carol and then Jane.
I think absolutely. I think the sort of themes that we would look at as contributing to that wellbeing economy are indeed fair work, our procurement and our whole approach to inclusive growth, trying to make sure that opportunities are open to all across our region. As you know, there's probably no specific funding allocated to the wellbeing economy, but we have a very, very strong focus on fair work across our whole agenda within HI. We're encouraging all businesses of all sizes to contribute to the fair work agenda and sign up to fair work principles. In terms of our procurement, we also look at that, and also looking at our supply chain about how that they can bring community benefit and contribute to the wellbeing economy through how they operate their businesses. So we're working, for example, with a supplier development programme on that to try and build that in, because it should be something that is endemic in our communities and our businesses. We're also working with Scottish Government on the sustainability test in our own tender strategies to make sure that we are operating on a level playing field and giving businesses, Indigenous businesses, as good a chance as others to participate in those procurements.
Thank you, Carol. And Jane.
Thank you. As part of our restructure, we've placed even greater emphasis on our communities team. We've also been part of the Scottish Government's Pathfinder on community wealth building and have been working with CLES, who have given us a report recently. So we're looking at exactly how we can embed and take that forward. We do have fair work written into our charter, and we now have a fair work team looking both internally to make sure we are doing everything we can, but also externally, because fair work is a conditionality of our funding. But we are taking a very tailored and bespoke approach, recognising that microbusinesses, communities, SMEs and others will all be at different points in that journey, and we want this to be a constructive and positive approach to supporting them through that, because the ambition generally is there from organisations to make those changes. We are doing the same with net zero at the moment as well, and we're actively looking at how we can engage and support microbusinesses, SMEs and communities in that net zero journey as well, and raise awareness, because there's a lot of businesses we've discovered in the south of Scotland that are already doing things, both in terms of fair work and net zero and communities also, but they don't necessarily realise that they are doing it. So we're looking at how we amplify and turn a spotlight on that as well. We do have specific teams and funds available to communities, and we are working in a very hands-on way to try and grow those, but also to grow the awareness of the support we can give. Because SOSAE being set up on the 1st of April, just as COVID hit, was concentrated, as were the other agencies, but was absolutely concentrated on crisis response and support. So we are now trying to ramp up awareness across the south of Scotland of the support and expertise, as well as funding that we can provide to help in all of those areas too.
Okay, thank you. Could I bring in Colin Smith, who has an additional question in this area?
Thank you, Rubina. I just wanted to follow up on the point around fair work that was touched on by both Jane and Carol. Obviously, when the legislation was going through Parliament to establish the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency, we included that requirement around fair work in the bill, and I pressed for it quite heavily, so I very much support that. But it is obviously a condition of grants for the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency to have fair work there. Can I ask Jane, first of all, does that bring challenges around a level playing field? Because you have that criteria, but Highlands and Islands and Scottish Enterprise don't have that criteria. And can I ask Carol just a follow-up? There's a lot of work in the Highlands and Islands around fair work, but you don't make it a condition of grants. Isn't that something, you know, I appreciate that's because your legislation's quite old, but surely you should be making that a condition for grants in the same way that South of Scotland Enterprise do.
Jane, would you like to come in first? I think that was...
Oh, certainly. Colin, I will let Carol come back on that because I do believe that high-end SE do have conditionality around Fair Work funding, but just set it at a different ceiling to us. I will let Carol respond more accurately than I. The key for us is that bespoke tailoring of what we're doing, because we recognise that to become a living employer without the support from us to realise different mechanisms to release profitability or to reduce costs in other areas to make that leap. There are also other areas of Fair Work that are important as well as that living wage piece. So we have a team who are experienced and specialised now to help organisations through that path as efficiently as and effectively as possible, with timescales that will be set by each organisation, but reasonable timescales. We don't want to extend this in a way that doesn't add value to employees across the south of Scotland. So it is something that we are hugely focused on.
And Cara, would you like to respond?
Just to clarify, we do have Fair Work conditionality attached to financial interventions over 100k. So there is at that level, and we strongly advocate businesses committing to Fair Work, undertaking the Fair Work assessment tool, and developing an action plan for all our levels of assistance. We very much promote and advocate a Fair Work approach. For example, we recently extended our graduate programme using COVID consequentials funding, and all businesses wishing to apply for graduate support were being encouraged to undertake the Fair Work assessment and commit to improvement. As an organisation, we work with all our clients on business values. So, although they maybe haven't signed up to the pledge, they can track their progress along the adoption of Fair Work practices over the period of time by discussions that we have with them, looking at that Fair Work assessment tool and plotting themselves against the various criteria to see how they're improving. I think for us, fundamentally, it's really about promoting the benefits of Fair Work, which are seen very much to enhance productivity and increase staff retention, which at the moment are pretty critical and fundamental to business success.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to expand a bit on this question of conditionality. Typically there's really been two things that are criteria that are looked on, the programmes that are in place focus on, which is the jobs created and the turnover growth. Should we move away from that completely? We talked about Fair Work, but there's also inclusive growth, there's net zero transition. All those things could legitimately become conditions. So should we increase conditionality? And if we did, how would that impact on the businesses that you're supporting? And maybe I can ask Carol to come in first on that.
Thank you. I think we've said before at this committee that in terms of encouraging businesses to adopt certain practices, we sometimes believe that carrot is better than stick. That said, I think conditionality is appropriate in certain circumstances. It has to be proportionate, and we have to try to avoid unintended consequences, which, you know, in some cases could potentially put businesses off. You've talked about turnover and jobs supported, and I think those are very important, but they're only the part of the picture and also need to be put in the context of a place-based approach, as I touched on earlier. You know, some investments that we make may not necessarily, create large numbers of jobs or huge increases in turnover, but they could have very significant impacts on the sustainability of a community, for example, or of a supply chain in a certain area.
So I think in terms of conditionality, yes, where it's appropriate, but just to ensure that it doesn't impact adversely on, for example, a certain size of business or a certain sector.
Do you believe that you could have a standard, if you like, portfolio of conditionality that would apply to all applicants, and then others that would apply perhaps more selectively to the business concerned?
I think that would certainly be worth consideration. We also have, you know, every time we enter into a legal agreement, an undertaking with businesses, it will have certain conditions attached to it which are appropriate to that business and that development. So that is quite tailored and quite bespoke. But if I'm understanding you by saying, you know, should we have maybe a range of levels of intervention or of conditionality across a spectrum of business size, business development, I certainly think it would be worthy of consideration.
Is it something you're considering?
Well, certainly in terms of fair work, yes, I think that is. In terms of net zero, we are currently, when we're looking at business development, trying to encourage our businesses and our staff to look at everything through a net zero lens to see if there's if a proposition could be improved or if there's a better way to help make that transition to net zero. So I think those are all things we are looking at.
But if we're looking at an inclusive economy, should we also have that incorporated as perhaps inclusive growth within the conditions? Automatically.
Sorry, fair work or inclusive growth? I think
overall, we're looking at growing an inclusive economy.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
Should there be some conditionality which relates to that within the conditions for all applications?
Well, I think in the way that HIGH operate as a regionally based organisation, which looks at a range of sizes and types of projects in a specific place context, I think that is working very much towards inclusive growth. We would look at, you know, different projects through a different lens in a very peripheral area or potentially an island community, as, for example, in the centre of Inverness. So I think appropriate conditionality, as I said at the beginning, is the right way to go. I think having hard cut-off levels, which are applicable blanket across our economy, probably wouldn't be appropriate. But I do absolutely agree that we need to look at inclusive growth, which I think is the way that HIGH do try to do things.
Jane, perhaps I can bring you in now, but in responding, could you perhaps comment on your submission where you stated that designing your processes, you've looked at things differently by not putting too many, if any, criteria against anybody applying for them? And could you maybe give us a bit more detail on that and what it means in terms of any conditionality?
Certainly. We do have conditionality specifically at the moment around fair work and, as Carol mentioned, other conditions that apply on a project by project, organisation by organisation basis. We're currently reviewing net zero and looking at how we introduce that in an appropriate and, again, tailored by each individual case way as another measure of conditionality as well. We are of a scale with a number of resources that means that we are able to tackle each submission at the moment on an individual basis. So we work, as Carol highlighted, HIGH do, with each organisation, with each community to assess what is appropriate and applicable for each one on an individual basis at the moment. But it is something we're continually monitoring, and we do look at each potential support mechanism through three lenses, which all have well-being at the heart, and that's through the community, the environment, and the economic well-being of each individual project. The other side of that coin as well is something that Carol highlighted earlier, which is that we are looking at and redesigning our own performance measurement criteria to make sure if we are not applying something as a conditionality at the moment, that we are ensuring that we are measuring how successful we are in using it as an intervention. So that does include things like fair work and net zero. It includes inclusive growth. It includes things in some cases like generational return with some of the longer term investments and projects we're working on. But it's something that is very much a work in progress for us just now, and we'll need to adapt and evolve as our as we grow as an organisation, but also as the number of businesses and communities we work with across the south of Scotland grows.
We are a bit short of time, thank you. I am prepared to bring Colin Smith in for a brief question as it is his region, but then I will move to Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, Convener. Just following up on the question around the flexible approach to grant criteria, it's something I very much support. I wrote to your predecessor, Jane, pushing for that early on in the pandemic because it was clear that businesses were slipping through the gaps when it came to government support during the pandemic. But I'm conscious that approach makes it difficult for businesses to know, first of all, what's available. They can't just jump on a website and see the criteria for a grant, for example, and I've lost track of the number of businesses that I've directed towards you to look at the crisis fund, etc. And secondly, obviously, it's a good approach, but it gives you challenges around governance. I'm often asked by businesses, how come that business got a grant and I didn't? And, you know, it's not easy to tick the boxes around criteria. So how do you tackle those two particular challenges? Because I think it's an approach that we should be rolling out across other agencies.
Thank you. To come to the first part of that, we recognise that, and I think that's part of that pivot from crisis response to our focus on business as usual as the enterprise agency that we want to be and to become. So we have undertaken that client journey review. We have undertaken that from our website through all of our processes, from first point of contact, call centre, emails, the lot. And we are now in the middle of a complete repurposing and refocusing of all of those direct methods of communication and in training the frontline staff so that in a short time, when people go to our website, it will be clear that we are there to provide expertise, support, consultancy, and in some cases, funding and grants and loans as well. So we are simplifying all of that to make the messaging much, much clearer as the focus on crisis management and hardship funding, etc., reduces. Governance is something we take incredibly seriously, and we have panels that look at each application, that review them using the same approach, although tailored to each individual submission. We have a number of bodies that we work with, from our Audit and Risk Committee to committees involving a number of our boards, to make sure that all of our governance, all of our processes are transparent, are auditable, and are clear. So we don't have a tick box checklist for organisations, but we do work with each individual organisation to make sure the criteria that need to be in place are there, and to support them to make sure that we know where any gaps are and to close those before they come forward for that funding.
Okay, thank you. Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, and good to see you all. I want to ask about the transition to net zero, and it's to get insight from you as to what your sense is of SMEs generally, not necessarily all those that you work with in terms of a grant position, what their position is in relation to the transition to net zero for themselves as businesses, but also for their product and services. And what are you doing or plan to do to help support that transition to that wider SME community? And in terms of financing, how do you think this can take place, bearing in mind many SMEs are carrying COVID debt, so it's a big challenge. So I know it's a big question, we can only cover so much today, but I'd be interested to have your perspectives. Perhaps, Carol, if I come to you first, and then to Jane.
Okay, thank you. I think in terms of SMEs, I think it's a mixed picture. I think there's a widespread understanding of the climate emergency. However, I think there's maybe less understanding about what everybody individually can do. I mean, we've had a number of discussions within High and with clients about how net zero is everybody's business. In the Highlands and Islands, we have huge opportunities in terms of some of the kind of, you know, the blue economy, the green economy, But, you know, how we can encourage businesses in some of our more traditional sectors, you know, we rely heavily on tourism, food and drink, and we see it as a key part of our job to help sectors like that understand what they can do to help towards that transition to net zero. And that may be things like the circular economy, like developing their supply chains. We've had examples of local food supply chains being developed to support the tourism industry. So I think a key part of our role is to raise awareness of what can be done. We've been promoting a number of very real case studies, which demonstrates to other businesses, maybe operating in the same sector, the types of things that they can actually do to contribute. In terms of enterprise company support, we have been working with businesses to look to move into, for example, new supply chains. We've had businesses approach us about moving into the servicing of electric vehicles, of ground source heat pumps and air source heat pumps, rather than, you know, more traditional types of heating supply. So I think developing those supply chains and helping them move as well into a more net zero approach is something that we're very keen to do. But raising awareness, I think, is also critical.
And can I maybe just follow up that the point about how, as businesses themselves, as their own organisations, the things they have to do for their own heating, their own transport, etc., how that might be financed? If you can maybe touch on that as well, Carol.
Well, I think there are a number of organisations that can provide finance to businesses. There have been a number of government schemes in terms of boiler replacements, etc. I think what we're looking to do when we're supporting businesses is, one, we can help identify other forms of support for them, and we've done that both directly with businesses, but also there's a huge amount of information on Find Business Support. Sometimes some would argue maybe too much, making it a little bit difficult to navigate. However, we're always there at the end of a phone line. And in terms of their business development, as I think I said earlier, very much looking at every development they undertake from it with a net zero lens to see, is there a way we can do this better in terms of that overall transition?
Thank you. I'm not necessarily expecting either organisation to resolve this issue. It's more your insight, because you work with so many different organisations, and it might be your perspective, not just with those businesses that you give grants to. So Jane, that wider perspective as well, please.
Thank you. We have appointed our first director of Net Zero and are building a team around him that will work both internally. We've put our board and senior leadership team through Net Zero training, which has been hugely beneficial, I have to say. But also we have set up our first Net Zero Commission for the South of Scotland, working with partners like Zero Waste Scotland, SEPA, and a host of others to help us with the strategic input that we need for the South, but also to help us identify tools that are already there. So our team can put together a really constructive toolkit in the same way we have with Fair Work, or SMEs, microbusinesses and communities, to make that journey to net zero. So some really targeted tools and interventions are in process of development now, working with all of those partners. We've also found it really important to take the message out using that team. So we're running a series of events and seminars, as well as producing information for frontline staff that will reinforce all of that. As part of that, what we've been doing is going around the south of Scotland, actually, filming some of the companies and organisations that we work with in lots of different industry clusters and sectors, who are already doing really innovative things on the journey to net zero. But some of them are very practical, tangible, small step interventions as well. And we've just started pushing those out and publicising those, so businesses can relate to some of the direct things they can do, that they realise that there are small steps that can be made, that it doesn't have to be a big bang approach, and that if we all make the small changes, it can have a huge impact. We're also working on things like the Powering Change report that we published in summary pre-election. We are in the planning stage to take that forward. And as part of that, we are looking at aggregated interventions across different industry sectors and clusters to make some of the changes that Carol highlighted, to look at how purchasing power, for instance, with groupings like our regional social landlords, can be brought together to make a more powerful change in terms of energy supply or the sourcing of ground source heat pumps, etc. We're also working hard on some innovative projects in hydrogen and other areas that we believe will be of real value to the south of Scotland as we move forward. So I think it's the golden threads, but it's the warp and the weft approach as well.
Mm-hmm. That's very informative. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That now brings us to the end of the evidence session. And I would like to thank Carol Buxton, Nick Kenton, Jane Morrison-Ross and Anthony Day for their time this morning. That's much appreciated. We'll now move on to the next item of business. So we now move to agenda item 4, which is covered in paper 3. The committee is invited to consider the consent notification for the recognition of professional qualifications amendment, EU Exit Regulations 2021. The Scottish Government gave consent during the campaign recess. The purpose of the instrument is to make minor amendments to revoke savings provisions made in respect of the alert mechanism under the Recognition of Professional Qualifications Amendment, etc., EU Exit Regulations 2019, SI 2019 number 312. Following the end of the transition period, the European Commission confirmed it had withdrawn all alerts made by UK regulators, making it necessary to amend the 2019 regulations to remove these now inoperable statutory obligations. Are members content to note the consent notification? Thank you. We will now move into private session for the remaining agenda items.